Thank you. Good afternoon, folks. If we could grab our seats, please. We'll start the ceremony in just about 5 minutes or so. So folks who are still standing, please find your seats. Thank you very much.
Hello, hello. There is a car that is running up in the parking lot with no driver. If your license plate number 175, M as in Mary, B as in boy, N as in Nancy, please go shut your car off. Friends and families, we will be starting our ceremony in just a couple minutes.
Thank you. Hello, seniors and soon-to-be graduates. Please take your seats. On behalf of the Board of Trustees of the Catlin Gabel School, I welcome all of you who are here celebrating this class of 2022. Parents, guardians, grandparents, families, friends, teachers, and staff, thank you for supporting and championing these students as they cross this important milestone. Thank you to the trustees in attendance today who help steward the school. And to our school leadership team, we are so grateful to you. To the staff members who always rise to the occasion and have now created a fourth iteration of graduation in just 4 years. Thank you for your talents and for doing it so enthusiastically and sincerely. The pandemic gave us this tent and this new outdoor space for gathering, and of course, it presented us with much more. As we all reflect on the gleanings from the ongoing pandemic, we must honor these seniors in front of us. They had an unconventional high school experience, to say the least. They wrapped up freshman year, eager to be sophomores, while the word pandemic was hardly in their vernacular. Sophomore year was abruptly cut short, and junior year was spent learning remotely, mostly. A masked up senior year was disrupted by a new variant and more positive cases, but through it all, this class sharpened their adaptability skills and powered ahead. Pre-pandemic, a Catlin Gabel graduate was already one who was well-equipped to take on the world, the highs, the lows, academically prepared, and emotionally prepared. These students were surrounded by a community of friends who look out for each other, take care of each other, seeking justice, advocating, thinking critically, problem-solving, expressing their creativity, and staying curious. This class of 2022 is all of that, and then some. Further emboldened with well-honed skills, facing disappointments, embracing the unexpected, staying strong and centered when things once relied upon are suddenly out of reach, seeing beauty in fresh ways, being vulnerable and giving grace. Protect and exercise these skills and superpowers, class of 2022, as they will carry you through every stage of life. You will draw upon these skills through those inevitable bittersweet moments. It is more than reassuring to know that you all will be the ones to successfully confront all the challenges that surround us in new ways, driven by your values and fueled by your competencies. As parents and guardians, we are drawn to Catlin Gabel School for its authentic and intentional community of teachers and staff and families, all bound by a commitment to help our children reach and surpass their potential academically, co-curricularly, emotionally, socially. And we acknowledge, as an institution, we are imperfect, and we strive to learn and grow and create change, just as we encourage our students to do the same. It is a deep privilege to participate in graduation ceremony today and to witness this wonderful group of students rise up and cross a threshold into unlimited possibility and adventure. Be bold, and congratulations to all of you. Now please join me in welcoming our head of school, Tim Bazemore, to the podium.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this wonderful, wonderful ceremony, especially our seniors, class of 2022. It's great to be here in company with you. And congratulations, as Indra just said, for navigating quite a remarkable high school experience. Unique, I think it'll end up being. So here you sit on the cusp of opportunity. And I think we adults, to start, have an apology to make to you. And it's not an apology for all the mistakes we might have made as your parents and guardians and administrators, if not teachers. I'm talking about the apology we really need to make to you and your generation for the legacy that we are passing on to you. Environmental degradation, gun violence, international warfare, social injustice and inequity, and political tribalism. Your generation, again, as Indra just said, faces daunting challenges. And these challenges aren't your fault. And they're not all yours to solve, yet. We adults are still trying, yes? And we'll keep trying, and we'll keep at it. Listening to the senior appreciation comments at the assembly the other day on Thursday morning, I was so heartened and so impressed to hear about all the things each and every one of you has done and achieved and accomplished and contributed so far. It gives all of us hope to listen to who you already have become. And I'll be candid, I'm a little worried for you. The challenges I just listed, compounded by pandemic isolation and the amplifying power of social media, are creating a mental health crisis for adolescents across the United States. There's a palpable sense of anxiety among adolescents about the state of the world, a weight I don't recall feeling when I was your age. And I would wager that's true for other adults in the audience here today. Across this country, there's an unhealthy sense of urgency, a need to be seen, to be special, to achieve now. Many schools say it's their job to help you find your passion and your purpose. I actually don't agree with that in high school. My advice to you is actually to be patient about finding your path and purpose. It's important to do things you enjoy, and it's rewarding to go deep on interests and to learn new skills. It's really satisfying to feel expert at something that differentiates you from someone else in your class or in society. And it's certainly important to know and claim your identity. You've done all these things in your time here at Catlin Gabel. But few people actually settle on their purpose while they're in high school. What actually happens to most of us who are a little older than you is that along the way, we get an opportunity. We're asked to take on something. We learn something new. We encounter someone we admire and want to emulate. We try on a new job or we move to a new place. And we end up being and doing things we never envisioned when we were in high school. Our skills and our interests and our relationships coalesce over time into direction and purpose. That's the wonder. That's the serendipity. That's the beauty and the adventure of life. It's also part of the fun when you come back for reunions a few years down the road and you find out that actually people aren't doing anything at all like what they thought they might be doing or that you thought they might be doing or that they were featured as probably doing in the most likely to section of the yearbook. Some of you have a plan, you know, a college, a major, a professional path, like where do you want to live? And you may actually follow it. And that's a good thing to have a plan. And some of you right now, you know, your plan is I'm going to go to college, probably, and that's my plan for now. And that's good too. That's good too. Either way, in this moment, I just want to remind you of the rare and precious opportunity you have in front of you. You are among the most fortunate, I would say, 1% of 18-year-olds in the world. In the world. Entire globe. You are in that 1%. You have the privilege now, especially in the next 5, 10 years or so, to to explore, discover, experiment, take on different jobs, roles, interests. I'm not suggesting that you be a dabbler for the next 5 to 10 years, or a wanderer or a dilettante. You want to commit to whatever you do and start crafting a life worth living. You'll also need some money along the ways too. But please don't drive by this moment. Don't let the urgency of the world, or TikTok comparisons, or the clarity some peers may seem to have about their own direction cause you to feel inadequate or force you into answers that you may not have yet and are likely to change over time. Be patient about your path and your purpose. Your mental health, your well-being, your happiness depend on it. So take a deep breath. Smile. Relax. You are Catlin Gabel School graduates. Soon, you will be. Your wonderful teachers over here, and let's please give them a round of applause. Have taught you to love learning about ideas, others, the world, and also about yourself. You bring skills and knowledge to the world. You bring curiosity and skepticism. And you bring voice and confidence wherever your path may lead. That's good enough for now. It's good enough forever. Congratulations. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Mrinalini Keskar.
Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, I'm become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecies, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not, charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass, darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know, even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three. But the greatest of these is charity.
I'm Bianca, for those of you who might not know me. Kenny and Sue have given me the opportunity to introduce you all to our fantastically bright 2022 graduation speaker, who also happens to be a Catlin alum from the class of 93. In a year where we all have been adjusting and learning to work together again, where we have faced multiple trials as students, as a country, and as a world, we are so lucky to have someone who is able to recognize and amplify marginalized voices and see how these trials also give us the opportunity to coalesce and come together as a community. While being the CEO and president of the Urban League of Portland, a 75-year-old civil rights organization comprised of an impassioned group of activists who work together to empower Black communities across Oregon, a member of the Oregon State Bar, and deputy assistant trade representative under President Barack Obama, She is someone who is not only brilliant at advocating for others and speaking her mind, but also does so in a way that keeps her connected to her community. In her work with Urban League, she has increased health knowledge, helped with workforce development, and invested in stable housing, recognizing how the Portland housing crisis disproportionately affects the African American and Black community. Being an alumnus of Catlin, she continues to advocate for students through lenses of equity and inclusion by serving on the Board of Trustees. She is a perfect emblem of what it means to make an impact and to fight for justice and peace on both a micro and macro level. So, without further ado, I'm honored to introduce you all to Nikenge Harmon Johnson.
That work? Can you hear me? All right, there we go. Thanks, Tim. And thank you so much for that lovely introduction. It's always interesting to hear how people will introduce me, especially when I'm back home like this. Good afternoon, folks. As you've heard, I am Nikenge Harmon Johnson, class of 93. My class was half the size of yours. There's a lot of y'all. And I am delighted to see every single one of you. Some I have already met, but others I have come to know just from your teachers and from stories and from Sue and from Kenny. And I want to thank you. Although it's crazy you invited me back to do this, I want to thank you for inviting me. I'm honored to be with you here today. To celebrants, to our faculty, our staff, fellow alumni and fellow trustees, I am joyful, joyful to be here today. To our Board of Trustees Chairwoman Indira, the first chairperson of color of our Board of Trustees, first person ever. Thank you. Thank you for leading our group of mighty volunteers as we support this grand little community. To Roberto Villa, although retired from faculty and in Palm Springs, not here, I call his name because after years after I graduated, Roberto remembered me. He recalled wonderful details that I had forgotten. There are a few teachers in my past whom I treasure. He certainly is one, and I hope that you seniors have those special teachers of your own. Also, I want to take a moment to thank Jasmine Love for the care she poured into students and families and into the school itself. I appreciate you, Jasmine. Then, too, allow me to recognize the person who I esteem as the best leader this school has known. Tim, you continue to impress me with your level-headed focus on Catlin students and our mission. And despite the completely wild 3+ years that you and this school community have faced, you appear undaunted. And as someone who leads a multifaceted organization, I know a little bit about what you have gone through, and you continue to amaze me. Thank you for your leadership. I'm getting to it, class of 2022, but one of my fellow alums is sitting next to Tim, so thank you, Madam Head of Upper School. Thank you for allowing me to be here today. It's great to see you, Eileen. I think I called, the class of 2022, you're the reason that we're all here. I wrote and scrapped a few different drafts of my remarks. In the end, I decided I don't want to talk to you about the way things are. You are well informed about the world around you. Slaughter in Buffalo, massacre in Uvalde, invasion in Ukraine, hearings in Congress on seditious acts at the highest levels, the increasing costs of higher education, and even to buying a modest home has become out of reach for many, many Americans. The climate change emergency that threatens us all, state violence against Black, Indigenous, and other innocent until proven guilty Americans, hate crimes against Asian Americans, the pain, the injustice, the harm, confusion, illness, all of that is all around. You don't need me to explain the challenges ahead, seniors. You already witnessed them. Of course, there is joy and opportunity too, right? There are great moments and bright days just like this one. Many, many, many more of those ahead of you. So I decided not to talk to you about what is. Instead, let's focus on what can be, what will be if you decide to make it so. You heard Tim tell you that you're part of the 1% in the world, and Tim, it's spooky, but he's right. Through your work and willingness to do what is necessary, when I come back to deliver the commencement speech in 10 years, our country, our world, could be very different than it is now. And class of 2032, any of y'all out there, today is the second time I've been invited to speak to seniors on their graduation day. I'm hooked. I really like this. So please invite me back in a decade or so. I'd love it. So how can you cut through the grim realities and focus on building what can be? First, seniors, I want you to ignore people who tell you that change takes time. Disregard the message that you must be patient. I'll get there, Tim. I'll get there. People who still believe that injustice is an intractable truth and transitions only happen slowly, they haven't been paying attention to the global marketplace. They're not even paying attention to the reality in Portland. For example, the pandemic, you've already heard, right? Prompted businesses and governments and schools and churches and athletes and performers and our own families to change all the things. Many of the ways that we come together, the way that we go grocery shopping, the way that folks vote in this country, those who hadn't quite gotten around to voting by mail, all of that changed within weeks. How we attend class and go to school and spend time with loved ones changed on a digital dime. So class of 2022, is a global pandemic the only scenario that can prompt our society to behave differently so quickly? Are there other emergencies that we can decide to address in rapid fashion because we decide that it's necessary? Because our leaders tell us that this is the thing that we must do to save ourselves and the people we love. Well, now that we're able to see and to know that change can happen at the speed of a deadly outbreak, what other issues could we choose to meet with an immediate response? Whether it's erasing food insecurity in our breadbasket of a state, housing the houseless, or opening the gates of venture capital to more women and queer founders. Wherever your interests lie, you can toss out bad policies, you can nix inequitable systems, and place power into hands of those unaccustomed to holding it. And you can do it quickly. I would agree with Tim. Don't let the urgency of the world drive your decisions. You've got everything you need inside of you to make those decisions for yourself. We'll talk more about what that means, and you don't have to be in a hurry to do it, but when you find it, blow through. The power of now is what you hold, so push for progress. Next, some of you knew before I got on stage, I suppose, that I work for the Obama White House. I knew that the speaker's selection committee would have checked my LinkedIn page. Appreciate that. Well, we who voted and worked to elect President Obama thought his victory was a major triumph for the United States. And electing the first non-white president with his skill set was certainly important. Let's fast forward from then to electing his successor. Voters elected an entirely different kind of leader in the Donald. As a student of campaigns and policymaking, I'll tell you one thing that the past administration demonstrated to me is that policies, really whole federal agencies, trillions of dollars of spending, can change direction within months. Just look at the legacy that a one-term president was able to create. Whether you were for him or against him, there's no denying that he incinerated many of the beltway customs that political insiders thought were fixtures. Americans and observers around the world learned that much of governing relies upon gentlemen's agreements and expectations to follow past practices. Well, when a president came in and decided to disregard much of that, he got a lot done for his agenda. Much of which is embedded for decades to come because he was most ardent about naming younger, like-minded people to the federal bench. Those judges and Supreme Court justices are shaping our country with each decision they make and will do so throughout their lifetime appointments. Jackson. What do you call a judge who the American Bar Association rated as unqualified for the bench?
Unqualified?
Unqualified? Your Honor. It didn't matter. They're still on the bench. Because a president decided what would happen next and built the coalition to make it true. So when you speak to your city council, when you advocate to the governor, when you testify before Congress, which I know some of you have already done and some more of you will, when you become elected and appointed officials yourself, don't forget the course of our national and local governments are in the hands of real people like you. The decisions you make can have an impact right now and well beyond if you are willing to make it so. Please don't get the idea that I'm encouraging you to follow the last president's political mode. I am not. 0%. I am telling you, class of 2022, to imagine what could be if all that power and all that spending had been used to combat the climate emergency. Or to make sure that every town in the US has clean drinking water, like our very own Warm Springs Reservation in Oregon. Or to open doors for entrepreneurship for more disabled Americans. Disabled Americans have the highest unemployment rate of any other group in the country, no matter how well the economy is doing. What if all that power, that spending, had been used to ensure an influx of underrepresented women in medicine, or new lawyers who would dedicate themselves to joining the public defense bar? I might have easier access to a doctor who looks like me. Data shows that Black women who see Black women doctors tend to have better outcomes than sisters who don't. Or, Oregon could already have hundreds more public defenders to live up to the state's constitutional responsibility to provide adequate counsel to people that the state accuses of crimes. Right now, that ABA again, they say Oregon is 1,300 attorneys short in providing public defense. There are hundreds of Oregonians right now sitting in jails without attorneys. While folks dither about the way things should be done and say, you must follow the rules. There's a process to these things, young people. Wait your turn. Don't you let anyone make you believe that the rules we have now are the only rules. You've seen proof that large institutions and public opinion can quickly change. It was young people like you who stood in downtown Portland night after night raising your voice to declare that Black lives matter, that justice matters. It was your insistence, youth voices, that pulled the wall of moms into the street. You weren't led by elders, they were led by you. Some members of the wall of dads who'd never dreamed about civil disobedience, they followed your lead. So I can tell you for sure that when you're willing to lead with passion and with focus, you can make things happen. I can hardly wait to see the tables you will shake, the feathers you will ruffle on the way to building the beloved community. When I was in high school, I believed that systemic racism would be a thing of the past by the time I hit my 30s. It took me a while to understand that too many good people are too passive and too accepting of the status quo. I charge you not to become those people. What do I want you to do, seniors? First, don't buy into the myth that major change can only come slowly. Second, do not fall for the falsehood that the rules we have today are the ones we must tolerate tomorrow. Please repeat after me. Urgency.
Urgency.
Transformation.
Transformation.
I know you can thread the needle between what Tim said and what I said, right? We can have a seminar after this if you want. Third, seniors, through your bravery, you can create the world in which we may all thrive. You may never be braver than you are right now. Even those of you who may feel uncertain about your next steps or even your own identities, look at how much you've already accomplished to be right where you are today. Unfortunately, you will encounter people who will try to rain on your parade. They will try to stifle your ideas or slow your roll. These people can be small but noisy opposition. Maybe they're your faculty advisor. Maybe they're your employer. Regardless, you cannot allow them to decide your courses of action. I see some cold stares from a few parents out there, but that's all right. We're gonna keep rolling. Naysayers aren't necessarily bad people, y'all. Often they just wanna protect you. They love you and they want you to be safe, or it's their job to look out for you. Sometimes, though, they just aim to protect themselves from change. It's likely that those people have forgot this day when they were in their own seats with their caps and gowns ready to graduate, the power, the possibility that they felt is all a thing of the past for them. You can listen to folks who are closest to your heart and still be brave enough to follow your own lead. Truly, my memory of what it was like to be 16 and ready to get out of here to build my dreams remains clear. I remind myself to hold on to that feeling. You may notice it in your bodies right now. Your sense of justice and how to build it are sharp right now. Don't let go of that edge. Your youthful bravery will help you create what others with more experience, who are greater in age, and who have more resources even believe is possible. For the loved ones of these grads who might be freaking out a little bit because you worry what might happen if they take my advice to heart, calmate. I took my own advice, and look at me. I turned out great. Seniors, you can create the life that you want for yourself too, but your work is also required to build the community you want to live in. No dilettantes, no bystanders. The 1% in the world. Catlin grads build resources and leadership everywhere you go, and many of you have already started. So please repeat after me. Urgency.
Urgency.
Transformation.
Transformation.
Bravery.
Bravery.
As I deliver that charge to you wonderful young adults, I'm gonna take just a moment to have a call in for the older adults who love you. Have y'all noticed the number of faculty and staff of color who are separating from this community this year? The Great Resignation is at play. Sure, it's affecting all of us, including the Urban League, but it should give us pause that the one area that the unparalleled Catlin Gabel School cannot manage to be excellent is in the hiring and retention of diverse staff. While I know Tim's commitment is genuine, we also have a long way to go to admit and retain Black, Indigenous, and Latin students. We've repeated the same refrain since I joined this community in the 80s. My fellow trustees have heard me say that Catlin wins in every area that we choose. We win state athletics titles. We win robotics team honors. Our endowment is envied by some colleges. This school enjoys a resilient base of support even when we're getting our butts kicked in the news headlines. When we decide to accomplish a goal, I've never seen Catlin Gabel miss. Look at this beautiful graduation, the fourth iteration in 4 years. We can do whatever we want when we set our minds to it. So why then does a robust, stable, diverse faculty, staff, and student body elude us? It's only because we, this community, hasn't committed to inclusion. When we buy in, we will surely hit the mark. Until then, I guess we'll have middle school students who have to suffer racist taunts from fellow Catlin kids. Are you okay with that? I know my seniors aren't, but you, the adults in the room, are you comfortable with such inequity? Y'all, while they're thinking about that, let me talk to my seniors again. After spending so little time on campus in the past 2 years, I didn't really get a chance to know you. And given all the changes that you've weathered, I wondered how much we would have in common as fellow Catlinites. So I read the latest issue of Catlin Speak, highlighting you, and there's an article written by Alexandria and Kalini, reported what seniors mentioned as some of their favorite memories from their time here. I thought it would be a good way to learn something about you. Well, I read that Ethan dipped his pants in a toilet bowl some years ago. A few of y'all thought that was hilarious, yep. I don't know Ethan. Ethan, where you at? Ethan? Hey, how you doing, Ethan? I can only imagine the story about the dunked pants, but my search for connection with y'all was it was off to a rough start. Next, I read about a bouncy house that came to campus. Like, we're insured for that? That's amazing. For a little stress relief. That sounds like a lot of fun. But some of y'all seem most amused by, not by jumping around on it, but when it toppled over. Like, that was the best part? Ethan did it, is that what I'm hearing? Ethan, my guy. I'm sure you are well-loved by this class. I didn't stop reading, though, because if there's one thing Catlin kids are good at, it's reading on and on and on with little chance for a happy ending. So I kept looking for some good news. Then I read Seth and Liam's words. You two brought it home for me, with good memories of Winterham and Catlin Speak at place. Your recollections made it clear that we share some of the same faves about our school. That gave me comfort that when I walked into this tent, we could connect with each other in 20 minutes or less. Now, as I prepare to take my seat, class of 2022, I wish for you and for all of us a commitment to self-interrogation about what is possible for a better, stronger, healthier, inclusive society and our roles in creating it. I wish you joy, most especially in the midst of our shared sadness. I thank you again for doing me the honor of saluting you and giving you this one last assignment, a charge for your lifetime. Feel urgency to build justice, not to follow the crowd or the Instagram or the TikTok, whatever the thing is, your sense of justice. Feel it urgently. Take action to transform bad policies into good ones. Stay brave. In those ways, you will foster joy for a lifetime. Congratulations, seniors.
And teachers for an amazing 4 years. I appreciate you so much. Sometimes I wish that I could freeze the picture and save it from the funny tricks of time slipping through my fingers.
Thank you, class of 2022.
Love you, Mom.
Thank you for that lovely music. I'm just here very briefly to introduce you, to introduce to you Hazel Walrun. Hazel has taught me a lot this year through her care, compassion, and perseverance.
Sometimes when I look at my face in the mirror, I am surprised by how different I look. Like, how did years slip by and transform me just like that? I can see my freshman self imagining what I look like now, how I've changed my hair, who my friends may be, how I ended up doing in math classes, and how I feel about graduating from high school. Recently, she's been following me around a bit. I could see her here and there on the class trip last weekend, standing by the sand pit and watching me run in the rain, water dripping off my shoulders. In these last moments of traditional childhood, she's my little reminder of how far I've come. I hope you can see and embrace your younger self as well. The amount of times I've heard unprecedented these last 4 years feels like an oxymoron. We've lived through a global pandemic, a new chapter of civil rights protests, the escalation of Israeli-Palestinian conflicts, the war in Ukraine, the increasing threat of climate change, the debate over Roe v. Wade, and so many more tragedies and revolutions. It's exhausting living through history, isn't it? I used to read history books and imagine, what would I do if I were caught in the turning point of the world? With all that potential right in front of me. And then I found myself immobilized, terrified, hopeless, uncertain. We wore paper masks on our chins and sanitized our hands until they were dry and leathery. We stopped hugging, shaking hands, or performing together, and had to transition to elbow touches and crinkling our eyes to show we were smiling. We tapped endlessly through Instagram stories with pretty infographics about all the ways the world was ending, and then switched over tabs to work on our English essays. There were a lot of moments during these years that I had to struggle to keep up my grades and care about tests, because everything was falling apart around me, so what did any of this matter? I drew in a panicked breath, and thought, nothing is ever going to be the same. And then I breathed out, and I realized I was right. Nothing would ever be the same. The tragedies of today reshaped all of us, and we all trudged through, turned in our assignments, and lived through the history of high school. Now I look up and think, when did Adrian get so tall? How long did it take for Arlo or Mike to grow their facial hair? What did I do before Neely and Issa got here? In you, I see fledgling adults caught on the precipice, teetering this way and that as they try to catch their balance against the wind. I wish I could say I got to know every single one of you during my time here, but I didn't. However, there is an intimacy in growing up together. I saw you in your awkward freshman phase, how you found your niche, lost and gained friends, disappeared for a year online, and then popped up again, taller, wiser, kinder, and even more stressed out. Each moment lived here at the school was a changing point, a small one, but significant in our transformation. I would like to celebrate all of your hard work getting through high school. I know it wasn't easy, but you can take your sigh of relief now. We have been so resilient, so flexible, so strong these 4 years, but we finally did it. You may know that I have disagreed with Catlin administration in the past and spent most of this year, pushing for accountability in the face of shortcomings. And yet, I am standing up here today. I'm sure we've all heard Bill and Blythe's trademark saying, there can be multiple truths. And I finally found the wisdom in that statement. The rage, frustration, and sorrow can sit next to the joy and love. I pushed the school forward only because I believe change is possible, that this community can do better, that there is a hope of making an impact. During my time here, I have again and again utilized the skills Catlin has ingrained in me: critical thinking, persuasive speech, and the value of equity and kindness. So, I will not tell you that you should cherish your high school experience. I will not pretend it has been perfect. But I will say that what you have gained from the school is precious. Don't ever lose it. My journey through Catlin has been colored by the many amazing teachers, friends, and family members who have raised me. To my mom and dad, surprise, I'm speaking at graduation, and I wouldn't be here without you. Thank you to my friends for dancing, singing, laughing, crying, and of course, studying with me through every major moment in my life. Beyond that, I appreciate every classmate and group member, every person I've stood next to in the barn lunch line, and every person who has met my eyes walking out of a test and synchronized an exasperated sigh with me. Thich Nhat Hanh writes, "You are the way you are because I am the way I am." In this way, every one of you is what makes everything I am, and vice versa. I'm standing here today wishing every one of you well. May we someday bump into each other on a busy street and talk like old friends, even if we never were, and exchange stories from high school so that neither of us lose this moment in time. May we link on LinkedIn or keep following each other's lives on Instagram. Time, in reality, is not as linear as we perceive it to be. In this very moment, we are simultaneously graduating and playing with glow sticks on the ninth grade trip and telling our kids high school stories. We are living in one magical moment always. At least that's what I believe. And in this moment, we have finally reached the top of the hill and we can see down both sides. We can catch our breath a little and maybe bend over with our hands on our knees. The road behind was sweet, and the road ahead is sweeter still. Thank you.
Thank you, Hazel. That was wonderful. And now it gives Aline and me great pleasure to announce that the class of 2022 has satisfied the requirements for graduation from Catlin Gabel School, and we will move to presenting diplomas.
Kamran Udin Ahmed. Aiden Bernard. Kyle Blackburn. Greta Bogdansky. Jeffrey Burt. Miles Campion. Akira Xavier Chase. Grace Chen. Megan Raggio Cover. Esme Abigail Cowing. Isadora Cox. Caleb Kress. Kendrick Ann Dolan. Kalani Dana. Lola Die Gonzalez. Aaron Julia Alton Doherty. Liam Dwyer. Yeah. Hunter Everett Farnham. Sophia Elizabeth Fields. Eli Francis Foster. Dylan Michael George. Jackson Carter George. Luke Cooper Gerard. Angelica Gratchner. Thank you. Samira Grossman Forrest. Bianca Hamilton. Joshua Gabriel Hamlet. Nathan Harris. Mike Hart. Isabel Heston. I'm going to pause for the new microphone. Why is 6 afraid of 7? Because 7, 8, 9. Okay, I forgot where. Marcus Ho.
Luca Jackson. Ethan Jubb. Kennedy Koss. Rinalini Keskar. Julia Ann Kyer. Seth Knights. Hannah Renee Langer. Benjamin Lee. Adrian Long.
Elysia Tien Ma. Arlo Maslin. Sophia Victoria Morrow. Nayan Aravind Murthy. Alexandria Emma Nagy. Stephen New. Isa Okamoto. Yeah. Maya Ray Paymar. Natalie Claire Potter. Oliver Reed Prendergast. Fiona McNeely Rain. Shiv Stewart Renjan. Felipe Rueda Duran. Mia Runsfeld. Nathan Sales. Anya B. Sashajit. Gianna Brenlin Scipione. Sophia Elizabeth Scott. Anna Caitlin Semler. Aiden Sharan Connell. William Silver. Neely Silverman. Alexis Smart. Peyton Annabella Smith-Hebert. Sedona Sky Snyder. Emmalin Yajin Song. Marissa Delmeon Spires. Owen Alexander Stevens. Noga Tao. Hazel Alexandra Ann Walrun. Karina Wong. Sutton Warmkessel. Christopher Whalen. Oceana Ella White. Elijah Widows. Evan Williams. Peter Yee. Yeah! Ava Zhishuan Yu. Sarah Janelyn Yu. Yeah. Caden Kim Samastil. Maxim Kaya Seidman.
Families, faculty, staff, and friends, the class of 2022. Congratulations, congratulations. And now it gives me great pleasure to introduce our wonderful head of upper school, Aline Garcia Rubio.
Thanks for making that so fun. Congratulations to everyone under this tent, and to those who can't be here and are watching from afar. Board of Trustees, dearest faculty, parents, grandparents, families, friends, thank you for gathering in honor of these remarkable people. They deserve honoring. My dear cousin Paulina had a baby 2 days ago. She lives in Mexico City. And she's been sending these photos of a tiny human with eyelashless eyes, giant eyes. They remind me of E.T. a little. They also remind me of holding young children, as young as you, graduates. As how you were held when you were very, very small. And then, as you grew, you were held by the people witnessing you today, the adults in your lives. Through fevers and nightmares and scrapes and festivities, through decisions and through seasons, the athletic ones and the weather ones, and maybe in good morning greetings or the good night wishes, you were held. We, the teachers, and you, the audience, the graduate skin, have seen their growth with wonder, acutely aware of their potential, with the eager anticipation of what may come for them, through them. Because of them. Some of what Nikinga said. I see music being made. I see engineering designs. I see creativity and humanity and future diplomats and justice seekers. Today we get a glimpse of what they have become up to this point. As they leave this campus and move away, they will continue to become. What joyful anticipation. I really feel it. Almost like a birth. All that holding, all that kindness and support deserve honoring too. Let's take another moment to applaud the support that a special group of professionals has offered. The teachers have given so much of their waking lives, most of their energy and their intellect to educating each of these outstanding humans over pandemic curveballs and adaptations, but before that too. Dear graduates, as I think of what I might say that could possibly be helpful to you, I lean toward the wisdom gleaned from educators with whom I've worked, or authors and practitioners with whom I've experienced or practiced or who have read, sometimes repeatedly. Pema Chodron, Maya Angelou, and Cheryl Strayed, and Arthur Brooks, and some academics at the University of Chicago, plus poets who play well with words. I hear from them that we humans live about 4,000 weeks on average. That doesn't sound like too many to me. But I think that in the end, it's less about the quantity and more about the quality, as we say. So for the roughly 3,000 weeks that you may have ahead, I wish each of you, really each of you, a rich and good life. May you find whatever purpose comes with patience or impatience, and may you feel connected, and may you feel satisfied about how you show up to whatever it is that you're doing daily. And for that, I hope that these bits of advice will be helpful to that end. Find your truth and your power in your stillness. Being still allows us to see the extraordinary, the unexpected, and the ordinary. Like, oh, those apples in the Bremen basket, or the frogs croak by the main parking lot, the warmth that we've created together in our proximate seating under this tent, the extraordinary and the ordinary. Our brains and the whole of our bodies are amazing machines. You know this. Our neurons move information at the speed of light, literally. We could talk about physiology in that way, but I won't go there. Sometimes our brains move so quickly that we're left in a daze. I know you know this because I may have seen each of you working at fast speed in a daze, in the multitasking of a day of five classes followed by a volleyball match, and sometimes with the worry about your family in the background as you rush to do homework before bed. I've also seen you all come out of the daze. So I think you know that if you slow down a notch, or two, or seven, like we do when we turn the dial of an old radio, that like, we can find our stillness. We turn down the dial by paying attention to our thinking, to our bodies, to the sounds, a sneeze, a bird, to the light, and the people with whom we are. On cue. If we slow down enough, we can hear our own truth. Sometimes it is the truth of what we want to do. Sometimes of what we shouldn't do. Do I run that red light? Do I want to be with this person? Is this the job that will give me life meaning day in and day out? Do I take this drug? Do I lie to my friend? Most of the time, in the stillness, we know exactly what to do. I can tell you that the majority of the mistakes that I have made and the hurt that I have caused happened in the days of my monkey mind, in a hurry, not in my stillness. I bet the same is true for you. To be clear about the stillness itself, I do mean the physical stillness of your body, which I noticed that you got to. Sometimes we forget we have a body until we call attention to it. We can feel the tightness in our socks, or our bent elbows, and angled knees. Oh yeah, they're at an angle, the knees. What angle? And what is the texture of the skin on my elbow or the gowns that you're wearing? Feel it, go ahead. If you tried it, thank you. You're perhaps a little more still now for that tiny effort. I am also referring to the stillness of our mind, though. Remember those poplars behind you, just outside the paddock fence. You probably don't need to turn around to see them. The row of tall and thick pillars with some white bark and fluttering tender green. I know that some of you have played around them frequently. Now picture the roots and plant your feet like you are them. You can always be like a tree. And once you're rooted, notice your thoughts for a minute. No judgment, just watch your thoughts go like a train. Oh, that was fun, the apples, the banana too. Oh, I forgot the towel I was asked to bring for tonight. Oh, I love these shoes, though I dislike walking on gravel. What will we do after the ceremony? What was the plan? Oh, that was fun last night with my peeps. And where will I find my parents after this? As the train goes by, you might say, thinking. You can touch the train with a small Tinkerbell wand, and it will dissipate, ding, like a cloud. Just like that. We were just thinking. The stillness might come readily if you summon it with a thinking ding. You may also summon it by saying, I am here. The stillness may come from observation. We notice that the light is kind of dim in some places, really bright in some others. Or that one of our friends is actually sad. Or that our cat is so, so soft. Or our mother seems busy. Or we notice that the air is thick with water, and our chest feels full, swollen with pride. If creating stillness is of interest to you, let me guarantee you now that it will be beneficial to you. But if it is of interest to you, you will need to train on how to find it. As you would train to play the cello like Kira does, as you would train to dance like Marcus or Twyla or Chris or Angelica or so many of you do. The amazingness of such training is that it allows you to know yourself and access all of your power. In your stillness, you can deal with anything. I really mean that. Anything. You can deal with being scared, with feeling lonely. In your stillness, you can respond to any call to action. Any call to action. Even when it is annoying or inconvenient, in the stillness, you will be okay. You will know what to do and how to do it. Your wisdom is already yours. Perhaps the best part is that you will find unconditional positive regard toward yourself. Imagine that. This is a rare thing, by the way. We all carry a lot of self-doubt, and most of us are a bit harsh on ourselves. We talk ourselves down for having tripped over words or for not knowing what others know, or just because our shoes are not as spiffy or we don't dance all that well, or really for anything, for the humanity that makes us well be human. But with the unconditional positive regard toward ourselves, it is possible for us to peek through that curtain of indifference. Look out. And then we can bridge that gap that keeps us distanced from others. And that is where you will live most richly. That is where you will find compassion, which is my second recommendation to you after stillness. In one of my favorite books by John J. Muth, a boy who's about 6 or maybe 7, Carl, shows up in his long blue shorts and messy hair. Carl is scared of an elderly neighbor who yells at him and his siblings sometimes. One day, Carl's friend, a giant panda who sometimes wears a skinny red tile and nothing else, takes the kids to the neighbor's home. And Miss Whitaker says to the panda, "Why on earth did you bring these children here?" The wise and solid as a bear character who simply tells it like it is, says, "Hello, you look well. And we brought you some nice soup." To Carl, Miss Whitaker does not look well. She looks skinny and small, much smaller than she did when she stood on the porch yelling at them for throwing a ball in her yard. So Carl and the panda help the neighbor to her stiff bed and hear her explain why she can't see the pictures with her tired eyes anymore. And they spend the afternoon together, just that, an afternoon together. Carl paints a picture of a green apple. That interaction is about compassion. As Strait says, compassion isn't about solutions. It's about giving all the love that you've got. Sometimes that love is large, like the barn, deep like the Pacific. Like what you feel for the person you most care about when they are raw and vulnerable. Sometimes it is light, like the sunshine that peeked through clouds yesterday morning and a little bit today. Perhaps what you feel when you witness a lower school kid who's running down through the fir grove and trips on the cement path. Either way, as Carl's, our compassion comes from listening, from seeing the person in front of us, truly seeing. What was their day like? What about their childhood? Are they worried about someone? Are they worried like I am? That compassion is what keeps the connections in the brotherhood that Malcolm was referring to in his recitation yesterday. That compassion is what allows us to forgive, especially when we've been wronged, as we all have at some point. You know, we're all carrying a bunch of stories in our hearts and on our backs. Each person here today, we struggle with one thing or another. Mental distress, tall bills to pay, an uncle who is ill, aggression thrown our way, a broken back, a broken heart, a dying pet. We also carry lots of joy, pride in the goals we scored, the friends we've made, the meals we cooked, and what we wrote, or who we're with. If you look carefully enough, we are all connected through it all, the tenderness of us. But you do have to look carefully, past that curtain of indifference, in the clearing of the days. If you look hard enough and can truly see, then you will get good at love. And that is my biggest wish for you graduates, that you get good at love. Because let me tell you an open secret, in the end, it's all about love. If that makes you cringe a little, you can call it connection, or sisterhood, or partnership, or team membership, or family, instead of love. But I hope it doesn't make you cringe. John Cacioppo, one of those researchers I mentioned earlier, explains that we don't derive strength from our rugged individualism, but rather from our collective ability to plan, communicate, and work together. Kind of like a gravel bucket brigade. He says that to grow to adulthood as a social species is not to become autonomous and solitary. It is to become the one on whom others can depend. Whether we know it or not, our brain and our biology have been shaped to favor this outcome. So I say to all of us, we are wired for belonging. We are wired for connection. We're wired for love. One last thing. Strait says that the whole deal about loving truly and for real and with all you've got has everything to do with letting those we love see us. Graduates, you have allowed us, your teachers and your families, to see you. At one point or another over your high school days at Catlin, we saw you. We saw your light, your capacity, your trueness. Thank you for that. And know that we are proud of you, as you are. I hope that you are proud of yourselves. So walk out of this tent with your head up. You've learned, you are skilled, you are strong and kind and good. Let yourself be seen. If you know the song and you can sing it to yourself, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. You get to create your love. You get to create your life. Each of you, go do it. And congratulations. Once more, the class of 2022.